Do an overview of the two fundamental problems of calculus. These are the problems whose study ended up leading to the creation or discovery of calculus. And at first they seem like two very different problems, and eventually at some point in time we are going to learn how they are actually related through calculus. So the first is the idea of slope. So if you have just a regular old line here, let's say, I don't know, y equal to 5x plus 2 or something like that. You should have no trouble finding the slope of this line, right? You learned before things like slope is the change in the y over the change in the x, if you wanted to use the delta notation, or you could write it in the y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1 notation. Or since it's a line, you might have learned in algebra class that number in front of the x, the coefficient, that's going to be your slope. So in this case here, my slope would be 5. And what that means is, it means that as you move to the right a single unit, on my graph, you are going to go up 5. And if the slope had been, I don't know, 13, that means as I go right 1, I would go up 13. Similarly, if my slope was a negative 2, that means as I go right 1, I would go down 2. So the slope tells us how we move on our graph as we go left and right. The problem comes in when you don't have a straight line anymore. And let's say you have something like a parabola here. And right away, I hope you agree with me that there's no way to give a slope number to this. Because when you're on the right side of the graph, then as you go to the right, you're going to go up. So you would think that your slope is positive. Whereas if you're on the left side of the graph, as you go right, you're going to go down. So your slope should be negative. And so there cannot be any number that would give us a slope for this parabola. However, what we're going to do is we're going to say, okay, well, we can't get the slope for all the graph. Maybe I can find what slope number is over here and give one answer for this part and a different answer for this part. And so the idea is we're going to change our focus to find the slope at a specific point rather than for the whole graph. And we're going to learn how we might go about that. We're going to learn about the mathematical techniques that would allow us to accomplish that goal. And so what you're then going to have is you're going to have a different value of slope on the left side and the right side. In fact, every single point is going to have a different value for your slope here. And what we're going to do then is we're going to say, okay, well, let's find the slope at x equal to 1. And let's find the slope at x equal to 2. And find the slope at x equals 3 and so on. And we're going to find the slope at every different point. And then what we're going to get is we're going to get a graph of all these slope points here, and we're going to call that graph, that function, we're going to call that the derivative. Again, we're not going into detail in this video how to find that, but I'm just trying to point out that what we're trying to do is we're trying to find slope on graphs that are not straight lines. And let me point out one reason why we'd actually like to solve this problem, because if you have a graph, and if this graph represents the position, so, you know, say where you're located in some sort of fashion, some sort of measurement system here, if that represents your position, then in that case, the slope is going to represent your velocity. And so, obviously, it's important for us to be able to figure out velocity when you're driving your car. You need to look at the speedometer and see how fast you're going. Make sure you're not speeding. On the other hand, police want to have devices that can measure your velocity as well to see if you're speeding. Baseball games, they measure how fast the pitcher is throwing the ball. So there's many, many instances in the real world we want to see how fast something's moving, and it turns out that this slope is what's going to give it to us. And so all of this here, all of this is going to be solved by learning about derivatives. That is going to be the mathematical concept associated with this. The second problem that is fundamental to calculus is that of the area. Now, again, in your geometry class, you probably learned how to find the area of a triangle. The area would be 1/2 base times height. And maybe if you learned about rectangles, maybe you would have learned that the area is length times width. Maybe you remember if you have a circle, and no making fun of how bad my circles are, then you would know the area is pi r squared, and so on. But what if, let's go back to our parabola shape there, what if I draw this weird shape where the top part of it is based on the parabola here, y equal to x squared, and since it's curved there, that is definitely not a triangle. You can't get, you know, 1/2 base times height here. And what if you want to find the area? Well, that suddenly becomes a lot more difficult of a problem. If it's not one of the standard shapes in geometry, generally people get stuck on that. People were solving problems like this a very, very long time ago. And what they would do is they would take the shape and they would break it up into smaller shapes of rectangles and triangles, things they're familiar with, and they would use that to get approximate values of the answer. But eventually, we overcame that and we found ways to get the true value, not just getting an approximation. However, it's going to involve another concept, and that is going to be the concept of an integral. And that's something we're also going to learn in calculus. And so what the integrals are going to allow us to do is they're going to allow us to take some other random function here, and we're going to take some piece of it, and we're going to be able to find that area. And it's going to, we can find the area no matter how crazy the shape is on top. We can still do something like this to get the answer. So the process we're going to learn in calculus will allow us to find this answer even if it's not one of your nice normal shapes from geometry class. And the idea of this area can be a lot of importance. For example, that area might represent the total cost to a business over time. And that's something they would very much care about. They want to try to make the cost as small as possible. That area might represent the area, or sorry, not the area, the energy in a given system. So there's a lot of uses of both of these problems, and we're going to see some of them throughout the course, but this first video is just trying to lay down the framework for what we're getting at. And we're going to start the class learning about this slope problem, learning what are called derivatives, and then later we're going to switch in and learn integrals.